Dear students and my colleagues, welcome to the second series of Stress at Work Management and Prevention Part 2, wherein we are going to be dealing with the evaluation of stress, its effects, and how do we cope with stress at workplace. While we are to discuss about it, let's firstly look at effects of stress on the organization, which could lead to increased complaints from the clients, employees losing commitment to the success of the organization, increased accidents, increased staff turnover, increased level of absenteeism at the workplace, where it will also affect performance adversely. And also civil claims for stress that could actually be related to stress-induced injury. So wherein the employer actually would become a liability, insurance premium would actually be increasing at your workplace. Now, as we know that many people go through stressful periods in their life, some of which may be associated with their work, which requires some form of change. And typically there are examples from being promoted to higher position, greater responsibility of financial decisions, or classic takeover situation whereby the ownership of an organization could be changed. And certain uncertainties that could be there with regard to the security of the job. But when we talk about the measurement and evaluation of stress, we must look at people's lives as well, their personal lives, wherein there are various reasons or factors that could be actually forming the part of stress that they are dealing with. And such life-changing units are important for us to be looked at. There is over a period of 20 years, Holmes and Rall have done this research, which I am sharing with you here on the screen. You can see that there are various factors that they have laid out which refer to certain events in the life, and those life-changing units could actually be leading to the cause of stress. So what you should look at is regulate the changes in the lives, most of which are under your control, and the endeavor to stagger these incidents and intensity could then eventually be dealt with to perform better and deal better with the stress or within the stressful situation. So now let's look at certain stress levels in particular occupations as well. We find in the study done on the research done at the University of Manchester Institute of Science and Technology, that certain job professions are more stressful professions, when the individual is expected to deal with stress more frequently. So it includes things like advertising, journalism, teaching, construction, being a doctor. So you're constantly dealing with more and more stress, and for this purpose, there are certain questionnaires that should often be shared with the members working in these professions. You should constantly be asking them if, in case there is it is possible to predict the stressful events in people's life, how these occupations are perceived as being more stressful than others, and what occupations can be classed as being the most stressful one out of these. Now, while we talk about coping mechanism, it's important for us to understand that, to recognize that there are certain aspects of our lives which create our own personal stress responses as well, which, like we discussed in the previous lecture as well, that it could actually be traced in insomnia, digestive disorders, high level of arousal or loss of appetite, and certain other problems which are totally different in nature as well, wherein the awareness of employees to stress should cover these perspectives. So what we should then look at is to look at the following that we are discussing here, that there are a number of ways in which one can manage stress in our life. For example, you could become more knowledgeable about stress. So you should understand the process and effects of stress, identify the major sources of stress, situations and people that could cause it, anticipate stressful periods and plan for them, develop a repertoire of successful management techniques and practice them in everyday life. You should also be able to learn to identify opportunities for personal growth. Find your level of stress that is best for you, remembering that both insufficient or excessive stress can potentially be harmful for you. Then the next thing that you can do is take a systematic approach to problem solving, where you could define the problem specifically and divide it into manageable components that could be dealt with. You should gather sufficient information about the problem so that you can put it in perspective, discover why the problem exists for you, review your experience with the present problem, and then develop and evaluate a set of alternative course of action. While you do that, you could select a course of action and proceed with it as well. The third thing that you can do is you can come to terms with your feelings, wherein you differentiate between your thoughts and your feelings. You should not suppress your feelings. You should rather acknowledge them and share them with the others. You could actually be very flexible and adaptive and accept your feelings. That's most important. The fourth point is that you could develop effective behavioral skills. So where you should not use the word cannot when you actually mean you would not. Whether you have determined what needs to be done with your life, you must be able to act on your decision. You should be able to use time productively. You should be able to assert yourself, manage conflicts openly and directly. Avoid blaming others for the situation. Provide positive feedback to others. You should be able to say no. And deal with the problem as soon as they are appearing, instead of procrastinating on them and, you know, waiting for them to intensify. You should evaluate the reality of your expectations, avoiding both the grandiose and the catastrophic experiences. And next that you could do is you could establish and maintain a stronger support network, where you could ask for direct help and be receptive when it is offered. You could develop empathy for others. You could list six people with whom you would like to improve your relationship, and in each case, identify one action step that you will take towards such improvement. Rid yourself of dead and damaging relationships. Maintain high quality relations. Tell the members of your support network that you value the relationship shared with them. The next is that you could develop a lifestyle that will buffer against the effects of stress. So herein, you could regularly practice some of the vigorous stretching or recreational exercises, reduce alcohol usage, engage regularly in some form of systematic relaxation, avoid tobacco, obtain sufficient rest on the regular basis, avoid caffeine, avoid food which have high sugar, salt, white flour, saturated fats and chemicals. And make sure that you are seeking out variety and change of pace in your work style. So take total responsibility for your life and maintain an optimistic attitude, most importantly. You need not dwell on the unimportant matters. The next thing that you can do is concentrate on positive spiritual development. You could adopt an attitude that no problem is too monumental to be solved. Engage regularly in prayer or meditation. Seek spiritual guidance, learn to transcend stressful situations, have faith in yourself, believe in yourself, and increase your awareness of the interdependence of all things in the universe. Next thing that you can do is you could plan and execute successful lifestyle changes, wherein expect to succeed and approach projects one step at a time. Keep change projects small and manageable. Practice each change rigorously for 21 days and then decide whether you want to continue with it or not and celebrate your success. Most importantly, reward yourself whenever possible. Now you have to have certain personal coping strategies as well. It would include relaxation training, where you could choose a quiet place and you will not be disturbed, and you could lie down comfortably, ensure that you are warm enough because you want to relax your body temperature. Will also fall slightly. You could close your eyes and then take 3 deep breaths and sigh, which would actually relax the diaphragm and therefore your breathing as well. Mentally go through your body, physically tightening and then relaxing each part. Feel the areas that where you find the tension. Ignore outside noise interruptions by thinking of a lovely color or beautiful place or sound of water. To recover gradually, deepening your breath, you could start moving your muscles gently, and as you awake, very gently arouse yourself, get up by rolling onto your side and sitting before standing to avoid dizziness. When you're fully awake, stretch and take 3 deep breaths. After a few minutes, you'll feel refreshed and really alert. Now this relaxation period should be followed with a walk in the fresh air as well. Certain times you could actually refer to physical exercises. wherein walking, cycling, swimming, dance, aerobic exercises together could help you raise the pulse and breathing rate significantly. You could also play badminton or other sports, running, squash. So these are actually certain programs for stress control. Drugs is the last option that I would want to discuss here, where sometimes to manage personal stress program, you could actually look at the, if in case prescribed by a medical practitioner, you should, you know, there is a risk of dependency of drugs. But yet, if in case an individual is trying to cope with a problem, and you want to have a false, you know, you're going through a false sense of well-being, individual's ability to cope may be checked, and then accordingly, the drugs could be prescribed to you. Now, most importantly, we should look at certain changes in the management and stress, and in any consideration of bringing about a change, it's essential to consider effects of the organization on the organization and on individuals working within the organizations as well. So let's firstly look at certain obstacles to change, where first is lack of vision and mission. If the organization is not having any vision, no sense of what it wants to create in this world, then you cannot really hope to inspire and encourage the management or staff to embrace the changes that are required within an organization to make the workplace healthy. Lack of corporate values could be there. How do we want to act consistently with our mission along the path towards achieving our vision? Every organization needs to set these guiding principles so that you can mark your way if you want to work on day-to-day basis on these parameters. The next thing that is important is a lack of corporate values. How do we want to act consistently? And you should look at shared and appropriate set of guiding principles. You will have people doing different things in different ways, leading to a lack of consistency and conflict. Lack of attunement could also be there, one of the reasons, as people need to behave consistently, relying on them to ensure the right decisions and believing that they rely on others to do this, take the right decisions as well. So alignment and attunement will actually help you produce reliability, consistency, cohesion and integrity. Then lack of leadership ability could also be affecting you. The leadership is about mastering the change. As the rate of change increases, there is an urgent need for a new generation of leaders who have the ability to set lofty and strategic visions so that people can be aligned with the visions and be motivated and inspired, right? So the next thing that we find is top team ineffectiveness, where as always in change management, how the top team performs and behaves is of the utmost practical and symbolic importance. Individual ineffectiveness could be one of the causes, obstacles, wherein there are certain occasions when individuals will be shown to be ineffective in moving the organization goals or posts. The reasons could be various, for example, attitude problems, skill deficiency, interpersonal conflict, self-confidence deficiency could be there. Or any top team member could be displaying one of the characteristics as real liability to the process. So, correct mentoring is required in order to be sought. Then we have staff resistance to change. Now, there is a whole body of literature on resistance to change and how there are ways to overcome it. And whenever people are faced with a change in any areas of their lives, the stress arises when they feel lack the abilities and skills to deal with the new situation. The time when change is perceived as exciting is the occasion when people feel confident enough to start dealing with a new arrangement. And under such circumstances, people may positively even relish such opportunity. So, let's look at certain organizational changes that could be significant for us and how managers could ensure that people affected by the change can actually understand the very need of the change in the organizational structure. And face-to-face communication technique could be used to handle sensitive issues involved with the organizational change management. So at all times, there must be involvement and agreed support from people within the system. There must be an understanding by everyone as to where the organization is at present. There must be understanding by everyone as to where the organization wants to be. So mission and vision, development towards above aim should be planned, and achievable measurable stages should be kept in mind, and appropriate communication and its implementation should be done, and constant check should be done and managed successfully. Now, when we refer to certain personal changes, I would want to discuss here that anxiety is the first thing to be discussed, where it could arise from the awareness that events lie outside an individual's range of understanding or control. So people are unable to adequately picture what the future holds, and they do not have enough information to allow them to anticipate how they would want to behave in the new organization. They are unsure of how adequately construe acting in the new work and social situations could be there. The next is happiness, the awareness that the person's viewpoint is recognized or not, or shared is twofold, okay? So at the basic level, there is a relief that things are going to change and not continue as before. Whether the past is perceived negatively or positively, there is still a feeling of anticipation, possibly the excitement at the prospect of improvement. So people may read more into the change and will get more from change than is actually the case. Then there is fear sometimes, that awareness of imminent incidental change, that individual's core behavioral system could actually, be acting in a different manner. However, what you should think of is that you should see little change in the normal interactions and believe that people will be operating in much the same way, merely choosing a more appropriate but a new action. The next point is threat, where the awareness of an imminent comprehensive change in person's core behavioral structure could be there. People are unsure as to how they will be able to act or react, and what is potentially a new alien environment for them. So one where old rules will no longer be applied and where new rules are yet to be established. Guilt could also be there. For example, it would involve identifying the core beliefs and how closely one has been meeting them, recognizing inappropriateness of the previous actions and implications for the individual could cause guilt as soon as the person realizes the impact of the behavior. Now, depression is a general lack of motivation and confusion. Individuals are uncertain as to what the future holds and how they can fit into the future world. So, which is where the core sense of self leaves them adrift with no sense of identity and no clear vision as to how they must operate. The next is hostility, where at this stage there is a continued effort to validate social predictions, and the problem is that individuals continue to operate processes that have repeatedly failed to achieve a successful outcome. So the new processes would be ignored by them and at best actively undermined at the worst. Denial is the last point here, wherein there is a lack of acceptance of any change, and denial will be the impact on the person. People will keep acting as if change has not happened, and they will keep using old practices and processes. Now another point here that I want to discuss is that you should actually, in this case, focus on better time management, because many times people suffer stress through their failure to manage their time available effectively. The outcome could be panic, frustration because of items cannot be found, feeling of hopelessness, loss of concentration, anger at how things have worked out. A number of remedies that we could use to improve time management includes prioritizing and allocating the time, where urgent should not be mixed with or misinterpreted with important. You should say no more often than yes to people seeking to take up your time. Concentrate on one thing at a time. Break major tasks down into small bits. Do one small bit at a time. Make a to-do list. Manage other people's expectations, especially customers, to suit your time as well as theirs. Control use of time rather than letting time control you. Now, things to do to solve stressful situation. You could actually have yourself monitoring the physical flexibility. You could actually be looking at relaxation exercises. So when we talk about relaxation exercises, you could take one of the exercises we did was initially, you could have certain breathing exercises, you could follow certain meditation techniques, so that these would actually help you cope with stress in a better way. Now let's look at things to do when you want to improve time management. You could allocate time for planning and organizing. Taking out time to think and plan ahead is a time that you are spending well. So do it now instead of putting it off until tomorrow. Set your goals because they give you direction. Prioritize concentrate on 20% of time that would actually give you best returns. Make a list of things that you want in your to-do list. Avoid the distractions. Be very flexible. Allow time for interruptions and distraction. But by the virtue of nature of job, it may be feasible to plan ahead of 50% or less of one's time. Right? So consider your biological prime time. When you are at your best in terms of performance, it could be at night time that you would be performing better. You could have more concentration or early hours. Some people are morning people, others are night people. Knowing the best time of the day assists your planning future performance. Do the right thing right, which means that effectiveness, doing things right is efficiency. Focus first on effectiveness and then you can concentrate on efficiency. Eliminate the urgent. The objective must be to reduce those tasks classified as urgent to enable more important priorities to be dealt with. You could practice the art of intelligent neglect. Eliminating trivial tasks or those tasks which do not have long-term consequences. It may be necessary to reduce your expectations on a range of issues. You could conquer procrastination as well when you are avoiding something. Break it into smaller tasks or set a timer. Work on the larger task for just 15 minutes. Learn to say no. Too many people suffer from overload because they haven't learned the art of saying no. There are more demands that are there. Assist in reducing the stress from overload if in case you follow saying no assertively. And reward yourself. Setting goals that are measurable and achievable is very important. When these goals have been achieved, indulge in the rewards that you have been promising yourself. Let's look at assertiveness training and coping strategies that are here on the screen shared with you. So there are many people who suffer feelings of inferiority, lack of confidence, self-doubt and lack of assertiveness. These feelings may have arisen in childhood, perhaps as a result of dominant parents, being bullied at school, racial discrimination at school, or as a result of sibling rivalry. Usually, they commonly apologize when it is not their fault, frequently blame themselves, and are not prepared to take change for any remedy of this kind of situation. Once this personality trait is established as a part of your personality, it's difficult to change, particularly in the later life. For some people, assertiveness training is the answer to it. Okay, so however, permanent changes could not be brought out in this way. But in order to have an effective training, there must be regular reviews of progress and behavior modification. And there are attempts to be made to remove self-doubt, analysis of specific submissive behavior. The feedback on how well or otherwise the individual has been dealing with particular situation and the advice on improving the self-confidence is essential. So as you can see on the screen, there are various points mentioned here. How you can actually practice long deep breaths, take regular breaks, eat balanced diet, avoid caffeine, use humor, practice good time management. You need not bury or hide your emotions. You can find relationships and that make you stress and end them if in case possible. Really listen to what people are saying rather than getting upset. if in case you disagree with them. So these are certain pointers to help you cope with strategies. Now in relaxation therapy, let's look at the deep relaxation method, where autogenic training is a training where the person imagines being in peaceful place with pleasant body sensation. The person focuses on body and tries to make parts of the body feel heavy, warm or cool. Breathing is centered and the heartbeat is regulated in this one. Mindful meditation is one which in which a person is concentrating on the body sensations and thoughts, and that occur particularly in that moment. The person learns to observe sensations and thoughts without judging them. Yoga or walking meditation has come from Zen Buddhism, and using physical discipline to focus the body and mind. It will actually be controlled breathing and slow deliberate movement and postures that are used here. Progressive muscular relaxation helps the person focus on tensing and relaxing each of the major muscle groups. Transcendental meditation allows a person to focus on sound or thought. A word mantra or a sound is repeated many times. Biofeedback is an instrument in which one can monitor certain changes in the body, such as skin temperature or brain waves. The person uses this information to try and relax deeply. Now, when I refer to brief relaxation methods that one could use, so it includes self-control meditation, a shortened form of progressive muscular relaxation. Paced respiration could actually refer to how the subject breathes slowly and deliberately. Deep breathing, in which the person takes a deep breath, holds it for 3 to 5 seconds, and then slowly releases it. This sequence is repeated several times and will help you release your stress. Now, there are certain benefits that are there in an organization. If in case you reduce the stress, it will lead to improved health and morale, reduced levels of sickness and absence, increased level of performance in the organization, improved relationship with work colleagues, clients and customers, reduced employee turnover, reduced employee costs as well. And on this note, I would want to tell you that everyone is subject to stress at some time in their lives. It may be associated with a range of incidents or situations. People would be much happier if they studied the causes of stress in their lives and adapted appropriate strategies for coping with these stressors. So hopefully, the whole presentation has provided you a number of strategies for coping with stress, including the personal relaxation and time management, two of the important perspectives to reduce the occasional cries that arise in the organization. And you can follow the 9 ways to manage stress until we meet again for another lecture series on a new topic. I hope this lecture series will help you deal with stress in a much better way. Thank you.